all up until the 90s with Dogma 95 by Lars von Trier. Okay, so let's go back to Cinecittà. Cinecittà, after the war, was restored. After a brief period in which it was used as a refugee camp, it was restored, and the American studios began to shoot films in Cinecittà. That was what made really the fortune of Italian cinema. Why? Like that it was cheaper than, you know, than filming in Hollywood. There were good professionals working in Cinecittà, so they would offer the same service that they could find in Hollywood, but for half or one third of the price. Okay, so the Americans came and they started to shoot in Cinecittà. For example, they shot Ben Hur. If you haven't, some of you may remember this film. But not just that. In reality, after the war, 3,000 films, films were shot in Cinecittà. 82 of them won an Academy Awards, and 47 won an Oscar. Okay, so to give you the magnitude of the importance of Cinecittà in the history of not just Italian cinema, but in the history of world cinema, really. So the Americans brought what the Americans always bring, money, okay, to an already vital filmmaking scene. Ecco, coupled to that, we have to consider what meant to go to cinemas in the 50s and in the 60s, when cinema going was a mass popular activity. There is a fantastic description here offered by Christopher Wagstaff, who is an important professor of film studies here in the UK. He's retired now, he used to teach in Reading, I think. So it describes what cinema used was at the time. And this says, and I quote, "People went to local cinema in their own street or the next one. The film changed every day or two. And people generally did not bother to check what was on. They went after dinner when they had finished eating, regardless of when the film began. This would generally be sometime before 10 o'clock, which was when the last show began. They would watch the film around the point they came in during the film. During the film show, they would talk with friends, sometimes paying only sporadic attention to the film. The ticket price was very cheap, indeed. The cinema would show a completely heterogeneous assortment of films. In the 1950s, this was when cinema met the working class." Okay, and we have photos here of, you know, people queuing to enter the cinema. But also, the second, this is an example of the sale parrocchiali, which were the parish churches. By the end of the 40s, the church controlled around 3,000 cinemas in Italy. Of course, the church was very much linked to the Democrazia Cristiana, which was the ruling party, the party in government. They didn't like politically engaged films, like the films of the neorealismo. They didn't want films talking about poverty and the problem, the troubles of the working class. They much preferred genre films because they were just pure entertainment. So the sale parrocchiali, but I would say the cinema going habit of the Italians in the 50s and 60s constituted the ideal environment for genre films, for films of pure entertainment. The first genre to emerge in the late 40s, early 50s was melodrama. Not a surprise at all, because melodrama means, it comes from the Greek, means melos, means singing, and drama is drama. So it's a sung drama. What is a sung drama in the Italian tradition? It's opera, of course. So melodrama films were cinematic transposition of Italian opera. So not transposition, because the stories were different, like the cinematic version of opera. And you know, all of you know how much Italians love opera, or they used to, when, you know, especially in those years. So the melodrama of the 50s was the popular genre par excellence, playing on Italian people's deeper values, family, faithfulness, male honor, because the danger of the male honor being jeopardized was one of the recurring themes of melodrama films, and permeated with Catholic values, especially the idea of redemption through martyrdom. Like, we will always have stories of family torn apart by unexpected turns of destiny, and then the final recomposition of the family after usually the woman has made some sacrifice herself for the sake of the family. For example, let's see the plot of Catene. An husband kills his wife, ex-boyfriend who has blackmailed her. He flees to America, but is sent back to Italy to stand trial. The only way he can be set free is for his wife to confess to adultery, which she did not commit, but she confessed the adultery, letting her husband believe that she was promiscuous, that she was adulterous. Of course, in this way, the husband is spared the jail, but of course she lost every honor and she's estranged from the family. Tremendous drama. Let's see a little clip from Catene by Raffaele Matarazzo to give you the tone, the sense of how these films were. Apology for the very slow.
Ma che succede, Antonio?
That's the wife. Ah, don't want to see her anymore.
Ma come hai potuto, Madonna Santa, come hai potuto?
Quando l'ho vista dalle tracce di figlio per tutta la testa, l'ho preso alla gola, siamo rotolati in terra. Lui ha tirato fuori la pistola, sono riuscito a levargliela e per difendermi ho sparato.
Ma cosa hai fatto, figlio mio, che hai fatto?
Ma zitta, ti prego, non gridare, non mi fa stare il tempo. Vieni, prendi il denaro che avevo da parte, che si mira per un
dove
po',
vai?
Non rischio di avere la notizia.
Dove vai?
Non lo so, non lo so,
dove
mamma.
Vai?
I figli! Please notice the music, of course, very melodramatic music. The guy, the actor is the great Amedeo Nazzari, who, by the way, came from Sardinia, like our Luca here. He was regarded at the time as a sex symbol, really an Italian sex symbol. The actress is Yvonne Sanson, she was Greek. Okay, let's have a look again to the history of Italian cinema. Oscar won by Italian films. Look, 1947, 49, 57, 67. And then we get to 1974 with Amarcord, and then there is a black hole. For many years, Italian film do not win an Oscar, and this is rather telling because those are the years of the crisis of Italian cinema. We will address this topic again. The same Golden Palms won in Cannes by Italian films. Again, you can see that until the 70s, a good number, and then again, there is a black, a moment of crisis towards the middle of the 70s and up until the year 2000, where basically Italian cinema never recovered from that crisis, as we will see. This is the number of cinema goers in Italy, an incredibly high peak, very large number of cinema goers up until the 50s and 60s, then it goes down, but still a good number until the mid of the 70s, and then a dramatic fall in the number of spectators, in the number of tickets sold. The same can be said for the number of cinema and Oscars. You see, the number of cinema is incredibly high throughout this is 75, also the day in which in 75 was introduced the law that smoking in cinemas was no longer allowed. Okay, so the ban on smoking in cinema, which was a huge blow for cinemas, because Italians at the time liked to smoke, and so the number of cinemas is incredibly high. until the 70s, and then there is a dramatic again fall in the 80s and 90s. And there is some, here you can see the situation improved slightly recently, but that is due to the creation, to the introduction of multiplex. The multisala, as we say in Italy, which, however, broadcast American, they show American blockbusters rather than Italian films. So the moment, the recent increase in the number of screens, of cinema screens, didn't have a beneficial effect on the Italian cinema industry, or not much. Okay, so let's go back to our genre films, because we can say that there is a sort of clash or rivalry between realism on one side, neorealism, art films, and genre on the other. Although for some authors this is not really true, because there are some authors argue that the entire all Italian films are genre films. That somehow even the masterwork of neorealism were genre films to some extent. But anyway, art films are not against popular cinema popular cinema like genre films, but rather they should thank popular cinema. Because in the 1950s and 60s, the Italian cinema industry was extraordinarily robust, and the art films, realist films, that defined the Italian cinema internationally were only a small part, productively not the most important, of a thriving industry. The Italian art cinema of the 60s thrived in part because of the Italian films industry as a whole had a secure economic base, which was provided by genre films. So were the genre films which provided the gross income, the turnout, which would fuel the Italian cinema industry, and which will pay for those art films, the great masterwork by Fellini, Antonioni, blah, 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 which sold abroad, but not so much in Italy. And anyway, not all of them were actually box office hits, many were not. While Italian genre films were regarded as almost safely produced in turnout. Ecco, here they are, my heroes, the genre films, a flourishing and export-oriented cinema industry. Horror films, spaghetti western, comedies, sci fiction, and then Sword and Sandals. Also, very interesting, that was the least nationalistic of the national film industry. In fact, the Italian films, they tried to pass for foreign films. They didn't want to. So while the art house films, the films of neorealism, they wanted to look Italian, because that was the trademark, no? That would allow them to be sold, to be booked abroad. For genre films, it was the other way around. They tried to pass as American films. So they didn't want to show that they were made in Italy. So to the point that, first of all, how did they do that? First of all, they would cast foreign actors in the leading roles or in secondary roles. Usually there was a mix of Italian actors and foreign actors. And then the directors would use pseudonyms, okay? So they would use foreign names. And here, for example, Mario Costa was John W. Fordson. Antonio Margheriti was Anthony M. Dozor, sometimes with the M, sometimes without, for some reason. Giorgio Stregani was John Finlay. Alfonso Brescia was Al Bradley, Al like Alfonso, of course. And Enzo Castellari, perhaps the greatest of all, was E.G. Rowland. Now, here, in this clip, you see Quentin Tarantino's homage to the Italian B-movie masters. In fact, you will see that he mentioned Antonio Margheriti, but also Tarantino's film is Inglourious Bastard. Perhaps you have seen this film, which is a remake of Enzo Castellari's Inglourious Bastard. So that the entire film is a quotation, is an homage to Italian film genre.
Ich befürchte, dass ich kein einziges Wort Deutsch spreche. Es sind Freunde aus Italien. Nicht hier. Ist der hervorragende Sensationsdarsteller Enzo Gorlone. Ein sehr talentierter Kameramann, Antonio Margheriti, und Antonios Kammerassistent Dominique de Cocco. Signori, questo è un vecchio amico mio, colonnello.
So, in this scene, a very famous scene from Inglourious Basterds, Quentin Tarantino pays his homage to Antonio Margheriti and the great and the other great masters of Italian B movies, of Italian genre films. Italy, between the end of the 50s and the beginning of the 60s, was experiencing the boom. The boom was basically the economic growth, in terms of economic growth, but also especially in terms of industrial output. For example, gross domestic products raised at the time was, every year was 78% of annual growth, which nowadays we call a Chinese performance, okay? So only China can do something like that. The industrial worker reached the 40% of the population, the national income, growth of the 50% in 10 years, which was a phenomenal performance. There was, new industry, dramatic growth of urban population. Urban population means more people having access to cinemas, so more tickets sold. And of course, there was also, this affected to some extent also the cultural industry of the country. We can skip this one. I was just to tell you that, most of the miracles was performed by small entrepreneurs, often uneducated, but with great talent and bright entrepreneurial intuition, who, exactly like the masters of Italian genre film, tried to pass themselves as foreigners. Zoppas, written with those font which suggest a German factory, but in reality Zoppas was a guy from Veneto, okay? Fonola with the H, or Candy with the Y. So they tried to mask the fact that they were made in Italy by taking on foreign names, names which would sound either English or German, because we know that Germans are very good at making electric and electronic stuff, mechanic stuff. So that's why Zoppas. It's very interesting. That was the same time which American cinema started to celebrate Italy as the land of fashion, style, and great food. The myth is born. Roman Holiday started in Naples, and then Dustin Hoffman in The Graduate, who drive Alfa Romeo. All these created the myth of Italy, along with films such as La Dolce Vita that we mentioned before. The cinema of the boom, was the genre film which characterized the boom were the Sword and Sandals. In the US they are called Sword and Sandals, in Italy we call them Peplum. Sword and Sandals film are a specific class of Italian adventure or fantasy film that have subjects set in biblical or classical antiquity, often with plots based more or less loosely on mythology, legendary Greco-Roman history, and other contemporary culture of the times, such as the Egyptian, Assyrians, and Etruscans. Here I quote from a book, these films depict muscle-bound heroes, professional bodybuilder, athletes, wrestlers, or brawny actors, fighting tyrants and or fantastic monsters, and saving scantily clad beauties. Rather than the lavish epics set in the classical world, they are low-budget films that focus on the hero's extraordinary body. Here they are, you see, translated in various languages because they were exported abroad. Les Amours d'Hercule. You see, those were the girls that would appear, you can see them here, that would appear in these films. They were half naked. Now, by modern standards, that costume seems very innocent, but think of the Italy of the early 60s, a Catholic country. There was a lot of skin to be seen, okay? So it was very alluring. Also, these girls were the so-called maggiorate, they were called at the time. How can I translate maggiorata? A woman having a generous breast, a large breast. That's what a maggiorata is, okay? So, and they were invariably cast for this kind of film. Also, those films were in Technicolor, which was a plus, eh? Because most of the films of the time were in black and white. So the chance to see, you know, something in Technicolor, eh? Here we have La Vendetta di Ursus, starring Salman Burke, a Canadian bodybuilder. Because as I told you before, they would cast foreign actors in order to, you know, sell the film abroad.
When my daughter has become the wife of Zara.
Sandra didn't say who it was.
Don't you believe me? Your accusation is one that has to be weighed with the utmost caution. But there's not a moment to lose. We gallop day and night so that we could warn you.
I'm grateful to you. Therefore, I'll have to retract my word and put an army into the field to force him to return my daughter to me. But that means a war against Kaya, which you're compelling me to do.
If you want to see these films, they're all on YouTube now. So you find the entire films on YouTube, both in Italian and in English. So you have plenty of, they're a bit boring by you know, seen today, but you know, they have a base of fun. It's easy, again, I'm quoting from a book, The Cinema of the Economic Miracle, you see The Cinema of the Economic Miracle, with its easy to follow plots that celebrated masculinity as a kind of mythos, the people found international audience among classes whose existentialist worldviews were not yet modernized by the changing international economic structures. And in a sense, the niche created by the peplum films provided a ready-made audience for the spaghetti western, which is, you know, perhaps the most famous of Italian genre film. We are talking about a cinematic phenomenon. The spaghetti western, we are talking about, you know, in less than 10 years, 500 movies. Okay, so an incredible cinematic output. And then we know the characteristic. I think we all have seen A Fistful of Dollars or the other films by Sergio Leone. Sergio Leone made only 4 or 5. All the others were by other directors, of course. When they saw that this film sold well, both in Italy and abroad, they started to produce, you know, dozens of them every year. While American westerns were generally family-friendly films, starring the good sheriff arresting the outlaws or the U.S. cavalrymen defeating the savage Indians, the Italian westerns offered a much more disenchanted depiction of the Wild West. Their heroes, inverted commas, were often bounty hunters of outlaws or outlaws themselves. They were not motivated by their sense of justice, but by their lust for gold. They were not much better than the enemies they would eventually defeat, which means mercilessly kill, because you kill a lot of people in these films. In fact, the level of violence displayed in these films was unprecedented at the time, and the body count astonishing even by today's standards. Just to give you an example, this is the famous Django, starring Franco Nero, the husband of Vanessa Redgrave, by the way, Franco Nero. And so famous a British actress. So see this film, the famous Django opens his coffin. Okay, there is a music that is not his actually. Okay. So there is a sovereimposed music which is not his I don't know if you can count the bodies, there are many, okay? Many Italian westerns were actually shot in Spain, though some were also shot in southern Italy, to depict the dry climate of the American Southwest. Old West set from several spaghetti western later became tourist attraction in Spain. In fact, if you go to Spain, you can still visit the western village villages which were built at the time by the Italian crews to shoot this film. This is Django. Producer will cast actors of different nationalities in order to help the films get booking in their countries of origin. The language barrier wasn't an issue. The films were all shot silent and dialogue was dubbed in later. So, and of course, the great actors of this season are Clint Eastwood, Lee Van Cleef, Franco Nero, Terence Hill, Bud Spencer also, Giuliano Gemma, and many others. Yeah, there is another clip, but I don't think we have the time to see them all. So I will, look, I think I'll, you know, can I take a few other, you know, extra minutes here? Because I still have a few slides. What do films teach us? What do you think is the relationship between cinema and society? Well, let me quote here a very important author, which will be me, Gianluca Fantoni. This is an article I published a few years ago, in which I argue that, and I quote myself, although not society, in some form, is such an intuitive and powerful idea that one cannot help but give it some credence. After all, cinema does not exist per se in a separate sphere. Cinema rather is like a piece of blotting paper absorbing ideas, cultural influences, and controversies emanating from the world in which it was produced. This is why, for example, that when in Italy there was the breakout of Contestazione, the youth revolt, the revolt of the youth against the establishment, and young people start to behave rebelliously, like we see here in a couple of in the short space of 2 years, they changed their look completely. And there was the myth of revolution worldwide, especially the Cuban Revolution, and the decolonization was filling the revolutionary dreams of young Italians as well as of young Europeans. There was a sub-genre of the spaghetti western, which was the Zapata western. Set during the Mexican Revolution, those films were allegories of the protest revolution which were taking place around the world. Those films had a clear left-wing undertone. Films like A Bullet for the General, Te Pepas, or Vamos a Matar, Compañeros. Let's hear Te Pepas' speech here, just, you know, a second.
I betray all of you, Mexico and the revolution. And as long as one single town in Mexico, one of you, doesn't have a piece of land, it is Madero's fault. And as long as in Mexico, just one rich landowner is left in this country, it is Madero's fault. And as long as in Mexico, just one rural, truth, killed and burned like here, it is Madero's fault. And if Madero doesn't know, this is what it is on the same. And more he doesn't know, this is what it is more he.
And this is Te Pepa. What happened in the 70s to the age of to the moment of revolution, which was, you know, the contestazione was rather joyful, no? Students parading in the streets, wanted to change the world, but what followed was not as good. Those were the years of the lead, the anni di piombo, known in Italy as anni di piombo, in which thousands of terrorist attacks were committed, were led, bombing, a lot of people killed by both black terrorism, which is neo-fascist terrorism, and red terrorism. So the communist-inspired terrorism of the Red Brigades. And of course, there was a reflection of that, again, cinema mirroring society, in the films produced at the time. In fact, not just the political crime, but also, you know, ordinary crimes, violent criminality, which was somehow a novelty for a country like Italy, triggered people's imagination, as proved by the emergence of a new cinematographic subgenre.
You know
what? Are you talking to me? No, can I go on? Okay. The poliziotesco, called Eurocrime, a sort of hyper-violent crime fiction. Somehow, those films were a celebration of suburbs, more than suburbs, sort of peripheries, really. Car chasing, violence, and nudity. In these films, policemen were as violent as the villains. They typically feature the character of the rough but honest police inspector who has to fight on two sides, against criminals and thugs, and against the inertia of the system that favors offenders, allowing them to get away with their crimes. Following the realization that the law does not protect the law-abiding citizen, the inspector eventually takes justice into his own hands. More or less, this is the plot of a lot of these films, who starred actors like Maurizio Merli, the blonde guy. We don't have much time, but let's see just a few, to understand what we are talking about. Roma violenta. Violent Rome. Okay, then women only feature like victims or like, naked women. I mean, there is no, they were either victims or like entrainees, prostitutes. There was the only role given to women in these films. These are very sexist films, if you like. I mean, definitely, yes. Yes, very sexist and male-focused films. And then the car chases, which were a really great piece of cinematography, by the way. Because there was no computer there, it was all... Okay, this is not loading much.
Auto per speciale.
Okay, we don't have enough broadband now, it doesn't matter anyway. If you look for Polizio Tesco, you can see a lot of these clips. The best things of this film is, of course, the posters. Posters are beautiful. Look at that. Il cinema con l'infame, il violento, Milano violenta, Franco Nero, il cittadino si ribella, Roma violenta, Marco il poliziotto, and many others. Another, of course, genre film of the 70s was Italian horror movies. In those years, Italians invented the splatter movies, a subgenre of horror films that deliberately focuses on graphic portrayals of gore and graphic violence. The great masters of these films are, of course, Dario Argento and Lucio Fulci. Lucio Fulci shot films like Non si sevizia un paperino. Now, the translation will be, you are not supposed to rape a duck, like a baby duck, which we can all agree with, is not good. It shouldn't be raping a duckling. And those are the kind of titles of those films. But Zombie, Shock, now we know Profondo Rosso is actually a masterwork. If you have the chance, watch it. It's not, it's viewer discretion advised. We are not gonna play now a clip because we are running out of time. We ran out of time already. The crisis of the 70s, no more investment for the US studios and the advent of private broadcasting. In Italy, it was a country in which at the end of the 70s, there were 676 independent television stations. This kills cinema, as people don't need to go to cinemas and buy a ticket when they have thousands of hours of free entertainment at home. Okay, so the advent of private broadcasting, along with the fact that American fans dried out, was the reason of the crisis of the Italian film. This is a beautiful quotation. When you watch the video, you can pause and read it, but we have to move on. The advent of VHS, cinema was about to change. The 70s would be the last decade in which films could be only viewed by the public collectively, projected in a dark theater, because of the television and because of the VHS, which following which the viewing of a film became a much more fragmented and private experience. Perhaps you have never thought of that, but that really changed the way of that we that we think and approach cinema. Italian cinema enters an irreversible crisis, but the Italian cinema industry refuses to die and is staged one last desperate, very low budget attempt to keep selling films in the international markets. This is really the Italian cinema last stand. And it's the low budget sci-fi films rips off films like Star Crash, which was quite clearly a rip off of Star Wars, or films like 1990, The Bronx Warriors. I'll give you just a taste of these kind of films, which are, were really poor, I mean, really low budget, and whose special effect were really... unclear in this film is why a woman should travel the space with that outfit, honestly. But, you know, anyway, Star Crash was, by the way, quite a success. Eh? It was a box office hit. I mean, it sold a lot, especially a lot of VHS. And it's still well known in the United States, for example, although now it's an object of mockery, but at the time, not so much. And then other films. And the other were erotic and soft porn. We are not gonna show any clips of these, just Emmanuel and the Cannibals, La Zia Svedese, which is the Swedish aunt, the islands of the Swedish girls. For some reason in Italy there is this idea that the Swedish girls are especially pretty and beautiful and somehow available, or and so there is this myth of the Swedish girl, Violenza in un carcere femminile, which is violence, sexual violence in a female prison, and so forth. And this is really the last slide. Italian genre films, gone but not forgotten. Well, certainly not forgotten, because there are a lot of fans of Italian genre films of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, both in Italy and abroad. We have seen, we have mentioned Quentin Tarantino among the many. But also not still around, not gone. An example of a modern day contemporary, let's say, genre film is the so-called cinepanettone, which started in 1988, the first one, Vacanze di Natale, and is still ongoing. Every Christmas, there are one of two films, which is, you know, Vacanze di Natale, Vacanze in India, Natale in Sudafrica, Natale a Londra, Vacanze ai Caraibi, Natale a Rio, Natale sul Nilo, which, you know, Christmas in a different place of the world, in which there are some female nudity, some jokes, but they are comedies, and comedies in Italian, comedies with a lot of situation of people, husband cheating on wives, wives cheating on husbands, but all in a framework which is of the one of comicity, no? of comedy. And that will be the end of this presentation. Sorry if I was, you know, a little bit longer than I was expected. I shall stop sharing now, I think. And we are back.
Thank you very much. Grazie mille, Gianluca. Grazie mille. I like very much. It was enjoyable to see the aspect of Italian movie over the years. I would like to see to give a chance to our guest tonight to ask some questions too. If you could, a couple of questions for Gianluca. Feel free to unmute yourself and ask the question. If anybody has got a question for Gianluca.
Or comment.
Or comment.
Hi, I've got one, yeah.
Yeah, prego, Bridget, prego.
Thank you. You mentioned Cinecittà in Rome. You can go and visit it. Do they do tours around Cinecittà?
I believe they do. When I went many years ago, yes, there was a tour. There are, in Cinecittà, if you go there are still, I think, the scenography of Rome, HBO Rome. So there is an entire Roman city rebuilt, and then other scenography. There was, at the time I went, there was still the scenography of Gangs of New York by Martin Scorsese. So now, of course, sometimes they fall down or they destroy it because they need space. But of course, now they don't shoot as many films as they used to, so scenography lasts for longer because there is no need of that specific area of Cinecittà for new scenographies. So now, well, of course, they are very sorry about the fact that they don't shoot many films nowadays. In fact, I think a lot of the people who used to work there now, they are retired or no longer, or they were laid out. It's another sign of the crisis of the Italian cinema industry, certainly. Cinecittà is not what it used to be.
Grazie.
It's more like a theme park, to be honest, when you, if you go by it now. I will say that, you know, the Centro Sperimentale di Cinematografia, which is on the other side of the road, where you go for the film archives and some so on, is still a very sort of high quality fascist building with lots of marble and beautiful courtyards. So it's one of the best places I've ever done some studying and research. It's very nice. if you can get over the connotations of the architecture, it's a very nice place to be.
Thank you for that. I see that you have University of St. Andrews. Well, my memory is recollection is a bit dated because I was there like 10 years ago last time. So unfortunately somebody was there more recently.
Thank you. Grazie mille. Grazie anche per le domande. Thank you for Bridget and Joseph. I've got a question for Michael. Michael Lane, prego.
Thank you. I think you brought out very clearly the link between cinema and the society of a given time, which changed, of course, through time. Do you have any comments about where Italian cinema is now? I happen to be lucky enough to be at some Italian festivals, and it strikes me that there are several films which are to do with the environment, which are to do with women's rights, and they are getting, you know, they are up to date, and the concentration on B films is no longer there. Is that accurate?
Yeah, it is accurate, but understand me, from my point of view, this is bad. B films are good. I mean, B films, from genre films are useful for the industry if they sell abroad. The situation with Italian cinema is more or less broadly the following: we don't produce many films. There is if you see the annual output, it seems quite impressive, like 200 films per year. But actually, only a fraction of them gets to the cinemas. So many of them are not even distributed. Another part of them are shown in a couple of cinemas in Rome, enough to get the contribution from the government, and then are retired by the producer who don't believe, especially the distributors, do not believe that those films are gonna make money. And also cinema owners have no interest in broadcasting showing those films because they prefer to show American films. So we are, so only a few cinemas get to cinemas, and those are mostly, those films. Some of them are successful. Some of them are typically two or three films every year are successful. Some of them, you're right, are very good. They address cogent, burning issues that needs to be addressed. However, they usually are not very appealing to the large public. That's why it's a problem. I mean, and this is due to the fact that there is a sort of circularity of author referentiality. Films produced by the left-wing intelligentsia or bourgeoisie for the left-wing intelligentsia or bourgeoisie. I don't have anything against the left-wing intelligentsia. I am myself part of the left-wing intelligentsia. However, I would like to also see, films that are appealing to the to the larger public. In the 60s there was, or the 70s, there was a famous, I don't remember, a famous film critic who said, si fanno film per il popolo o sul popolo. So we either do films for the people or on the people. So films that talk about, you know, they want to be slice of sociological investigation, so films on the people, or films for the people, so to be appealing to the people. So I think I have this impression that nowadays we produce a lot of the former and too few of the latter. So too few films for the people.
Thank you. Grazie mille. Thank you, Michael, for the question. Thanks, Gianluca. Anybody else would like to ask a question? Yeah. Ben, yes, please.
Thank you, Gianluca. That was really interesting. Really enjoyed it. In Britain, quite a few films recently have been made using television money. So the BBC and Channel 4 pay for or put the money up towards quite a lot of films that go to the cinema first and then end up on television. Do television companies in Italy put money into films in the same way?
Well, the Rai produced films, also Mediaset, Berlusconi's TV channel. Berlusconi's films, televisions were perhaps the main responsible of the crisis of the Italian cinema. Also because of the fact that Berlusconi was the first who started to broadcast hundreds of films on monthly basis. So if there were films in television, why to go to the cinemas and watch films? However, also in order to address the criticism labeled on him, he started to produce films back in the 90s. And also the Rai does, and the Italian government do. There is a law for financing films regarded of public interest. There are a lot of criticism about how those money, especially public money, are used, because they say that they finance films not because of the quality of the script, but because of political, connivance, or so if you are a friend of the politician of the political party who is ruling the country in that moment, you get the money for the films. I don't know, how truthful, how real are those accusations, and to what extent. But certainly, there is a lot of politics in when there is a distribution of money, there is politics in the middle. So there are criticisms about how the public funding for cinema had been used over the years, because as a matter of fact, a lot of the films funded by the government were among those who never got to cinemas. They were never distributed because people didn't want to watch to see them, or maybe they weren't given the chance by the distributors and the cinema owners. It is difficult nowadays to compete with the American film industry, with Avengers, or the big companies like Disney. It is objectively difficult. For example, the British film industry is in much better shape now, but not much in terms of films produced. The Britons are doing very well in terms of television products, so TV shows or TV series, relying also on the fact that, thanks to the English, they can be much easily sold abroad. It's quite interesting, the film industry in this moment. However, not because of the, feature films that goes in cinema, but more because of the television products. But that is probably the future now with Netflix and the other online platform. The future of both television and cinemas is in this, computer, this screen that we are watching now, and it's on the internet, of both the industries. Yeah.
Thank you. Grazie mille, Gianluca. Thanks for the question, Dan. Grazie mille. Have you got time for another question? Or a comment?
Well, I think it's more that film is global on different platforms, be that like Netflix or, cinema. And then there's cultural films like in Bollywood, which are specifically for your country or different cultures. But I was like interesting looking at the history of cinema for Italy, because it starts, you know, with its neorealism, and that's where it really starts, doesn't it? Where it really has that gritty vein in it. And then that sort of softens off. I don't know, what was it, white telephone movies? That was quite interesting, that little bit. But I think maybe now people people look for that gritty, not quite neo-realism, because that came from a very political place. But I think that people want something with truth behind it, you know, where the small independent person, you know, it's their writing, whether it's about society or, like you say, economy and the planet. Maybe there's another stage to come for, you know, movie viewing. I don't think we can call it cinema anymore, can we? At the moment, we can't even get to the cinema.
No, true.
So I think that will change things. But people are hungry for movies, for that entertainment.
Well, same kind of people. I mean, entertainment, yes. You know, in the British Anglo-Saxon world, there is more this idea that, which is more truthful, that films is both art and entertainment at the same time. That there must be an entertainment side of it, to it. Otherwise, people won't buy the ticket to go there. In Italy, these two things were more separated for quite some time. And still, we struggle to reconciliate them, you know, to make a film which is both spectacular, but also, you know, meaningful in terms, you know, politically or sociologically. I don't know, it's a difficult, for example, if I'm talking about British cinema, I like Ken Loach a lot. I think I've seen every single film of Ken Loach, but I don't know how popular is Ken Loach beyond the circle of the politically aware people. And again, Ken Loach does film on the working class, but I'm wondering how many people of the working class actually see the films by Ken Loach. So that's the film on the people or for the people that we were. It would be so useful if they did, but I'm not sure they do, because Ken Loach is not in the multiplex, he's at the Broadway cinema here. I'm sure you in Loughborough have something similar to Broadway cinema, so the art house film cinema, no, which they only show some types, kind of films. But the public of
In Leicester, that's right, yeah, there are some.
Oh, Leicester, yes.
Yeah. Excellent. So, okay. Thank you. Grazie mille, Gianluca. We've got time for one more question. Anyone want to ask or make a comment? Okay, I think it seems that's it. Okay, I wanted to say, first of all, a big thank you to Gianluca. So a big virtual clap and clap to Gianluca. We plan such an event before the pandemic started. The plan was to eventually meet up at the do a talk like we've been doing in the past at the Village Hall or the theater. We hopefully will be doing that when we'll be able to meet again. So watch this space.
Very glad.
Thank you very much. And Luca will be in touch. You're very, very kind to present for us tonight. Grazie a tutti. Thank you very much to all of you for joining us tonight. And we look forward to see you at our next event on the 19th of February. Okay. Grazie mille e buonanotte. Thank you.
Grazie Gianluca.
Grazie Gianluca. E ci sentiamo poi con calma.
Recording l'hai fatto, sì?
Sì, recording l'ho fatto, sì. Poi ci sentiamo in tutto, te lo mando, sì.
Ciao.
Buonasera di nuovo, grazie, ciao.
Ciao.
Papà, mamma, state ancora lì un secondo, ok? Buonasera. State lì, eh? Eccoci qua. Ma papà, non riesci a mettere l'audio, scusa? No, un attimo solo, eh?